subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with the hot favorite topic of the world, the vaccine development and its distribution. While countries have begun or are on the verge of rolling out the vaccine for its citizens, the mammoth task of storage and distribution of millions of doses stares at them. World is looking towards India, the largest vaccine manufacturer, to play an instrumental role in making vaccines available to even the remote corners of the globe.
After almost a year of gloom and fear, a year of death and disappointment, the days of the pre-pandemic era are finally appearing to be returning. Yes, the long-awaited COVID-19 vaccine is here. 90-year-old British Margaret Kinney became the first person in the world to receive the Pfizer COVID-19 vaccine shot outside of a trial. Hundreds of others have received the shot in the United Kingdom after this US vaccine was approved by London following its efficacy results of up to 95% after the second dose. Many other countries are considering it on priority. Dozens of other vaccines too are set to be rolled out in few weeks. But will that be a victory moment for mankind? No. In fact, the beginning of a mammoth challenge of producing them in millions and delivering them to remotest corners on the planet. With vaccines requiring specific freezing temperatures to sustain, the task becomes even more difficult. In such a scenario, the world has turned to India, the largest vaccine manufacturer in terms of capacity. The Indian companies are already working strenuously to brace up for the challenge. From vaccine container manufacturers to cold chain specialists and logistics companies, firms in India are getting set for the massive global blitz to contain the pandemic by freeing up capacity and accelerating investments even without firm purchase orders.
We are making sure that, as we said, we have added 300 million capacity, so we are making sure that we are geared up and can satisfy and hopefully give them everything they need on time.
India manufactures more than 60% of all vaccines sold across the globe. And while its $40 billion pharmaceutical sector is not involved in the production of the expensive Pfizer Inc. and Moderna inoculations, the country will play a pivotal role in immunizing much of the world. Indian companies are set to produce 8 more affordable vaccines designed to fight COVID-19, including AstraZeneca's COVID Shield, dubbed as the vaccine for the world by its developers. The country is also reviewing applications from Pfizer Inc., AstraZeneca, and Hyderabad-based Bharat Biotech for emergency use. Observers say it will be incumbent upon India to not only deliver the vaccine to its own people, but to the entire world, especially the poor countries.
The vaccine is going to trigger a large amount of activity in and around the manufacturing of vaccines. So therefore, the entire thing end to end needs to be managed well in the context of vaccine logistics. And therefore, the position in India is very, very unique compared to any other country globally.
Meanwhile, more than 60 heads of foreign missions visited manufacturing facilities in southern India as one of the world's leading pharmaceutical centers stepped up production of COVID-19 vaccines. The foreign delegates visited Biotech's facilities in Hyderabad, where the firm is developing a shot called Covaxin in collaboration with the government-run Indian Council of Medical Research.
India's capacity for producing, mass-producing vaccines is something that will, I think, make a huge difference in the fight against coronavirus.
The country of over 1.3 billion has announced that it will be rolling out its vaccine program in just a few weeks and will be vaccinating 300 million people in its first tranche. The country's COVID caseload of around 9.7 million has witnessed a significant downfall in infection rate in the past few weeks. From nearly 100,000 cases per day in mid-September, the daily infection number stands at around 30,000 per day. The country has one of the fastest recovery rates, with its mortality rate amongst the lowest. Observers believe a slow infection rate in India would be a boon for the rest of the world, as only under that situation can New Delhi afford to send more vaccines in other parts.
Moving on, Rohingya crisis is seemingly deepening, with Bangladesh relocating a large number of these refugees to an island in the Bay of Bengal. While the government says that it is taking decision in the interest of the refugees who were living in overcrowded camps, the rights group and international organizations, including the United Nations, have urged Dhaka to keep the process voluntary. The authorities have also been accused of coercing refugees into registering themselves for transportation through one method or another.
Last Friday, around 1,600 Rohingya refugees who have been provided a shelter by Bangladesh for over 3 years were shipped to a remote island of Bhasanchar in the Bay of Bengal. A few hundreds were already shifted before this. Dhaka says it plans to relocate 2,500 families to a remote island owing to the chronic overcrowding in the refugee camps in Cox's Bazar. The move has triggered strong reactions from rights groups and international organizations that say their transportation is not consensual and the island is not equipped with even basic facilities. Dhaka has rubbished all charges and said that it has made every possible arrangement on the island.
মানে 8-9 লাখ মানুষ 10 লাখ পর্যন্ত মানুষ একান্ত আসছিলাম বেশি ঘনবসতি তো আর তো যে মুক্তি পাই বললা বলি এখানে চাপ সময় বললা বলি আর আর 1 লাখ পর্যন্ত মানুষ লাড়ি বললা বলি হয়।
While the media has not been able to access the location thus far, Dhaka has claimed through graphics and images that the new settlements will abide by all humanitarian and refugee laws. It says it can accommodate up to 100,000 people in these homes. However, a few refugees claiming off the record that they were forced into putting their names on the list has prompted a controversy against the government. Even the United Nations has expressed its apprehension over the developments. United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, Filippo Grandi, through a tweet, urged Bangladesh government to ensure the process is voluntary and an informed decision. The Rohingya crisis erupted in August 2017 following attacks on remote police outposts in western Myanmar by armed groups alleged to belong to the community. These were followed by counter-attacks against the Rohingya, which human rights groups, including senior UN officials, have said amounted to ethnic cleansing. In the weeks that followed, over 700,000 Rohingya, the majority of them children, women and the elderly, fled their homes for safety in Bangladesh. The camps in Bangladesh, which already had 200,000 refugees living, were overwhelmed. Since then, the only roof over these refugees has been the unhygienic, overcrowded, flimsy shelters of Cox's Bazar. Repatriation, even after several attempts, has failed, and most of the people have developed a desperate urge to move out of this confinement. Some say they don't mind risking their relocation to Ireland, for it will take them away from monotony and unendurable density of population in the camps.
Moving on, the Himalayan nation of Nepal is swept by a growing anti-government resentment. Thousands of citizens recently took to streets demanding the reinstatement of constitutional monarchy in the country. They accuse government of corruption and incompetence. The government, according to the protesters, could not handle the COVID crisis properly. The observers believe that the growing internal feud within the ruling party has also paved way for the demand of monarchy.
Unprecedented scenes emerged on the streets of Kathmandu as thousands of Nepalese citizens held anti-government demonstrations and called for the restoration of constitutional monarchy. Carrying national flags, they chanted pro-monarchy slogans and said that the current communist government had failed in addressing the needs and demands of the people. Protesters also carried images of Emperor Prithvi Narayan Shah, the founding father of United Nepal, and raised slogans against Prime Minister K.P. Sharma Oli-led federal government. The demonstrators also demanded to declare Nepal as a Hindu state, as opposed to current secular status granted by the Constitution of Nepal, which was enacted in the year 2015. The government, however, has downplayed the protests, calling them sponsored. Protesters say it is people's movement.
Aaja kunai pani party le manche dakda kheri eti ko manche kahile aako dekhnu bhacha paisa diera gaadi ka gaadi manche dakera motorcycle ma tel hal diera khana de masu bat khana diera lyaunthe aaja hernus ta swata ispurta janta sadak ma aako त्यसमध्ये युवा केटाहरू सडकमा आएको हेर्नुहोस् त यो युवाहरूले अभियान सुरु गरिसकेपछि भोलि अवश्य हामीले सुन्दर नेपालको परिकल्पना गर्न सक्छौँ सुन्दर नेपाल यो देशमा राजस्वस्था पक्कै हुन्छ हिन्दू राष्ट्र पक्कै कायम हुन्छ जबसम्म हुँदैन हामी युवाहरू एकजुट हुन्छन् अर्को कुरो तपाईँहरूलाई जानकारी दिउँ यो राजावादी भनेर म पनि एउटा स्वच्छ नागरिक हो राजावादी भनेर यहाँ कचौरा बोकेर हिँड्ने पनि धेरै छ
The genesis of the re-emergence of the demand for the monarchy has its roots in the growing disillusionment against the government. People's perception has changed substantially against the government in the past 2 years. According to a report released in the late November by Transparency International, 84% of those surveyed said government corruption was a serious problem in Nepal. 58% believed that corruption had gotten worse over the last year. Observers, however, say that the internal feud between the top leadership of the ruling dispensation is the principal reason behind the crisis, and people seem to be losing their faith in the democratic form of government with every other incident in the power corridors.
There is a general disillusionment among people. So this could be an expression of that. And I think when democratic forces don't live up to expectations, both the ruling and opposition parties, then it's inevitable that some alternate force will try to take their place. So that is how I see the revival of this protest.
The modern history of Nepal began with Emperor Prithvi Narayan Shah starting the campaign of reuniting the Nepal in the early 18th century. After centuries of monarchy, Nepal approved a constitution in 1959 under which the first democratic election were held. However, it was soon replaced with another constitution that vested the highest authority and power in the king. The monarchy was finally overthrown in the early 2000s to establish democracy in the state. For a decade and a half, the country is being run by people's representatives in the parliament.
Moving on, doctors and paramedics in the illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan region held protest against the local administration and the park establishment. They say that they are being subject to double whammy of COVID-19 and harsh weather, and no allowances are being given for that. They say they had earlier followed the legitimate course, but the authorities have turned a blind eye to their cause.
Doctors and paramedics in the illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan took to streets against the government and accused it of discrimination and mistreatment. They shouted slogans against both the local administration and the Pakistan government, which virtually controls the region. Doctors have been demanding risk allowance for their services amidst the pandemic. They also say they have been denied promotion and a salary hike despite their years of services. Doctors say they were patient despite government's apathy, keeping the severity of the pandemic in mind. But its continued indifference to their problems has compelled them to take up the route of demonstrations.
पाकिस्तान के अंदर जो डॉक्टर और पैरामेडिक काम करता है वो कम सबसे कम उजरत पे काम करता है और ये सबसे हार्ड स्टेशन बाकी जगहों पे ऐसा होता है कि जो हार्ड स्टेशन होते हैं उनमें पे ज्यादा देते हैं डॉक्टर स्टाफ को ताकि लोग वहाँ पे आए लेकिन बदकिस्मती से यहाँ पे सबसे कम है पे रेस के लिए हमने अपनी सिफारशियात और चीज़ें सेक्रेट में दी हुई थी गवर्नमेंट को तो उन पर भी अभी तक कोई खातिर ख्वामल नहीं हुआ इसके अलावा हमारी जो पैरामेडिक्स के जो सर्विस स्ट्रक्चर था वो अभी तक डिफाइन नहीं है सर्विस स्ट्रक्चर के हवाले से हमने जो सिफारिशात और जो चीज़ें दी थी वो ये था कि केपीके तरस का जो है सर्विस स्ट्रक्चर दिया जाए जो कि पिछले कई सालों से जो है तातुल का शिकार है
It's not easy to serve in Gilgit-Baltistan. While on one side, the doctors are asked to run hospitals with inadequate and inefficient infrastructure, on another, they have to endure the harsh weather. While the other government departments like law enforcement agencies and Pakistan's deep state of army withdraws tens of thousands in allowance, the doctors are made to suffer with low remunerations. Most of them are not even on the government payroll and are earning just nominal contractual wages.
They पहले डिमांड जो है वो रिस्क अलाउंस का है, ठीक है। दूसरा हमारा जो है वो कॉन्ट्रैक्ट रेगुलाइजेशन का है, जो तीसरा हमारा अपग्रेडेशन का है, जो सीनियोरिटी के बेसिस पे जो है स्टाफ को अपग्रेड किया जाए।
The rising number of COVID cases has already exposed the poor health system of Gilgit-Baltistan. Many have already succumbed to disease, for they couldn't get adequate and timely medical attention. Amid this, Islamabad, which has controlled the region forcefully for over 7 decades, continues to harass those who are no short of savior. Doctors say their agitation will only grow stronger and wider if the demands were not met immediately.
Blessed with beautiful and abundant scenic beaches with long golden coastlines, India serves as a complete treat for sand artists who wish to bring their imageries alive by means of their art. Amid COVID-19 outbreak, the 9th edition of International Sand Art Festival was organized in Odisha to promote and showcase global cultural fusion. Let's have a look.
Converting the sand into beautiful art. At the 9th edition of International Sand Art Festival in India's Odisha state, artists showcased sculptures made by sand. The 5-day long festival was organized at Chandrabhaga Beach, which is nearly 3 kilometers from Konark. Almost 70 sand artists from different parts of the country crafted soft golden sand into spectacular sculptures. Well-carved sand sculptures were made on themes like coronavirus and climate change. Eminent sand artist Sudarshan Patnaik is the brand ambassador of the festival. This time, he was appointed as chief curator of the festival.
Due to COVID, इस बार तो सबको पता है कि इस हालत में entire world जूझ रही है। बट मैं धन्यवाद दूंगा कि उड़ीसा टूरिज्म को, तो वो इस फेस्टिवल को स्टॉप नहीं होने दिए और इसको कंटिन्यू करने दिए। और बट एनी हाउ उसमें थोड़ा सा चेंजेस हुआ है, जो फॉरेन आर्टिस्ट बाहर कंट्री से आते थे ड्यू टू कोविड वो नहीं आ पाए।
एवरी ईयर दिस फेस्टिवल इज सेलिब्रेटेड इन अ ग्रैंड मैनर and sees enthusiast artists from countries like the United States, Singapore, Russia and Italy. However, due to the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, international artists were not able to make it to the festival this year. Several precautionary measures have been taken to ensure that protocol was followed in the light of the coronavirus, including thermal screening of visitors before entry, hand sanitization, social distancing and pre-registration of visitors.
I feel great to be here. This is the first time in these 4 years I have been in Orissa. I am coming and witnessing this event. And looking at the enthusiasm of these young people who are sculpting these sand art structures, I can say that it must have been wonderful the previous years, but whatever it is, we are giving it its best shot. So I am really here to enjoy this whole ambience and feel good about it. The arrangements are fantastic. I can see that there is almost everyone is wearing a mask, and there are a lot of sanitizers around, and people are making sure that all the protocol is followed.
The Konark Festival gave the audience a glimpse of the culture and traditions of Odisha through colorful dance performances in the backdrop of the Konark Temple.
On that colorful note, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.